all connected. And when you find people who are trying to push for disunity, Brother Beta, or separation, or split the church, split the congregation, you ought to know that's not of God. Got a great anointing and started speaking in tongues. What was that? Nonsense. Because what did that have to do with anything? Bishop Bowers went there in the upper room. He preached, and they all shouted, and I guess they just had a historical experience. But it had nothing to do with anything because Jerusalem has come to us. If we never get to Jerusalem, it has nothing to do with us going to heaven. And by going to Jerusalem, I don't know. Some people say they become more spiritual. But I'm not willing to go to Palestine and put my life on the line just to see some tourist attraction. That's all it is. And wait for some terrorist or some person from the Jihad or Hamas or one of the other groups, Palestinian groups that is at odds with Israel, to get on a bus and blow everyone up. I will stay right here on American soil. Can the church say amen? So someone say heavenly Jerusalem. Now then here is the next one, read, and to an innumerable company of angels. Daniel said he saw 10,000 times 10,000 around in the throne, and then he said thousands of thousands, which is an innumerable a number that no one can number, around the throne. The thousands of thousands is the angels. The 10,000 times 10,000 that Daniel and John saw, Daniel in the book of Daniel, John in the book of Revelation, is 100 million, which is a symbol of the glorified church. I don't know that the glorified church is going to be 100 million. That would be about a little less than half the population of the continental United States. But I will say that 100 million is the number that Daniel left on record, John left on record, and it is a symbol of the glorified church in as much as both of them wrote prophecy in symbolic language. Are you listening to me? And so now I'll turn to someone and say, I want to be in there. Well, I would have to concur that that number is much better than 144,000 of the Jehovah Witness Church. So if I was Jehovah Witness, I'd leave the Jehovah Witness Church and get in the Pentecostal Church because my chances would be hundreds of millions of times better than 144,000. But this is what they have taught for many years, the Jehovah Witnesses, that only 144,000 are going to make it. And when they have come to try to witness to me, I've said, well, where do you fit in there? Because that's not a very a great number of people. That's when they were at Michigan State, I said it's 44,000 people here at Michigan State. I said, so where are you going to be? He said, I don't know. I'm just saying this is what the Bible says. I said, no, you have got the Bible out of context. This is speaking of a number that comes up out of the tribulation period. And because they don't believe in these kinds of things, then they were very confused. And they never could get very far with me. Can the church say amen? And to an innumerable company of what? Angels. Verse number 23. To the general assembly and church of the firstborn. Now, then he's talking about what? The church of the firstborn. The church of the firstborn is also referred to as the general assembly. We are the general assembly, and we have come to the what? Church of the firstborn. Now, someone said, what does the firstborn mean? Well, Jesus is called, in the first chapter of the book of Colossians, the firstborn among many brethren. Now, if he is the firstborn, that simply means he was the first one to be baptized in water to fulfill all righteousness. For when he came to John, he told John, John said, I have need to be baptized of thee. Comest thou to me? That's because John felt condemned because he was in the presence of God. He felt unworthy. Jesus said, suffer it to be so now, or permit it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. So he was the first one to be water baptized to fulfill what? All righteousness. And then after he was baptized, the visible manifestation of the Holy Spirit came upon him in the form of a dove, and God spoke out of him saying, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am." Now, if you read that, you would see he didn't say of whom I am. He said in whom I am well pleased, because God was announcing he was well pleased to be in that body. For God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. And so he was the first one to experience the new birth experience of being baptized in water and the visible manifestation of what? The Holy Ghost. That makes him the firstborn. He is the first in all things, for your information. And we are the many brethren, and he is the firstborn. And so the church of the firstborn, the first one to, of course, put this particular experience on record for all of us to follow. Now, there is no excuse. Years ago, one of our bishops was preaching a meeting. He said John, when he saw Jesus, he took him and baptized him and put him down in the water. And he came up out of the water, and the visible manifestation of the Holy Spirit came upon him in the form of a dove. So an old woman came up to the bishop after he was preaching and said, "I enjoyed your message, Reverend, but you made a mistake." He said, "Ma'am, what mistake did I make?" She said, "You said John put Jesus down into the water and baptized him. The Bible doesn't say that." He said, "No, the Bible doesn't say that, ma'am, but I'll tell you what the Bible does say. It says that Jesus came up straightway out of the water. I'll let you figure out how he got down in there." Now, you see, sometimes the Bible doesn't say everything just the way we want to hear it. But it is obvious that when Jesus was baptized, he was submerged in water. And this is what is significant with regard to our experience. Are you listening to me? So verse 23, to the general assembly, this is the church, and church of the firstborn, which are written where? And this is, turn to someone and say, this is significant. When you come into this church, God writes your name where? In the Lamb's book of life, which is kept in heaven with him. So this is why it is foolishness for people to come to church and act like they can't figure out how significant they are in the framework of God. That is insane. This is why people walk around and say, you walk around like you were so proud or confident. Yes, I am confident. The person that preached me out, David Uz, was confident. And Bishop Paddock was confident. Everyone that trained me was confident. So I have nothing but confidence. That's all I have. That's all I know. Praise the Lord. And I'm simply saying to you, you need to be confident too. Well, then he also said in this book, if you read it, Hebrews, cast not therefore away your confidence, which has great recompense of reward. For you have needed patience that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. And yet a little while, he that shall come will come and will not tarry. So you and I should be confident. Praise the Lord. So to the general assembly, please underline that. The article, the, is referring to the general assembly is the church. The general assembly is the church. And church of the what? Firstborn, which are written where? In heaven. Who else have we come to? And to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect. Now, this is what many people don't understand, Brother Crump, is they get in here and they don't realize they're dealing with who? God. And that's Combs. And this is what they thought in the council. That's Combs. But it is interesting, as I have said so many times, that every time people get parked at the Greater Bible Temple, they get judged one way or the other. Whatever it is, if they come in here acting a fool, it comes out. That has just been the way it's been. And that is because you cannot come to a place where the word of God is being taught on a level or all things are being dealt with as they ought to. And if you bring something in there that will upset what God has established, then God will do what he has to do to expose it. And people, of course, have found that have come through here. Praise the Lord. Young man from Muskegon found out. My brother and sister-in-law found out. Bishop Parshay's son found out. I can go down the list. You come to God's church and you don't bring your agenda. You come to God's church to get God's agenda. You leave your agenda out there. Just dump it in the trash can on the way in the door. Don't bring it in here because it's not going to work. Praise the Lord. Now, when I'm dead and gone, I don't know what's going to happen. All I know is that as long as I've been here, we have done nothing but establish what we do here on the scriptures. And I tell people I like to play golf, so I play golf. I like nice things. I have nice things. I believe in living a prosperous life, and I live one. Praise the Lord. And I have benefited very well outside, but I don't bring that in here and try to transform the church into a marketing scheme or use the ministry to prostitute a gift so I can make money. You do that stuff out there somewhere. Not with the ministry. You find, turn to someone and say, buy a franchise and work like a Hebrew slave like the rest of us. But you don't bring that into the church. And this is what you see more and more of in our day. Praise the Lord. And this just is not right. Turn to someone and say, it's not right. And this is what is getting these preachers in trouble. This is why people are stomping their wives, kicking them and choking them. Oh, yeah, it is. Because people are bringing things into the church that shouldn't be in there. If you just kept it simple and preached and did not try to turn the ministry into some great promotional marketing scheme, then there wouldn't be these stresses and strains on relationships. And they're trying to keep up with the Joneses and saying, God's going to turn me into Oprah Winfrey and Dr. Phil. God is not into Oprah Winfrey and Dr. Phil. Oprah and Dr. Phil. Now, Dr. Phil does go to Bishop Jake's church, but Dr. Phil is not representing the gospel. God is about the gospel. Though we or an angel from heaven come preaching any other gospel than that we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. The church is supposed to be about the gospel, not about all this entertainment that people have taken it into or have dragged the church into the middle of. But this is what people want, and so people do whatever they want to do, but you read the scripture for yourself. Except the Lord build the house. All that work that they're doing is in vain. And the house is built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets. Jesus Christ himself is the what? Chief cornerstone. And so we must constantly remind you of these turn to someone and say these wonderful things. So we have come to God, the what? The judge of all. And this is why things in the church must be judged. Are you listening to me? Now, some people don't like God's judgment. Peter chapter 4, the time has come, and now is the judgment must begin where? At the house of God. And if it first begin at us. Why? Because we have come to what? God, the judge of all. So judgment begins where? At the house of God. So then, of course, Paul told them to judge the man that was having sex with his father's wife. That would be his stepmother. And in your Bible in Corinthians, he said such fornication as not so much is named. That meant that there wasn't even a name for it. It's not as much as is named among the Gentiles. That a man should have his father's wife. Now I listed a list of those names of all of those acts of ungodliness that this bill that was introduced by John Conyers and Ted Kennedy and some other people, where they're trying to pass what is called the Employment Non-Discrimination Act. And they want to legalize pedophilia, transvestite, transgenderism, homosexuality, lesbianality, beastality, urinality. Now, this is where you have sex with urine. And yes, I named all of them. Feces. I named about 30 of them that are in the bill. They put this stuff in a bill and sent it to President Bush's desk. And guess what? Turn to someone and say, guess what? He ain't going to sign it. You can go have sex with your feces all you want, but it ain't going to be, it's not going to be in no bill on President Bush's desk. These people are crazy. I got the bill in my office. It came from Reverend Lou Sheldon's desk. But see, some of us are deep in this political thing. We know what they're doing. And some of us are basically on the outside and don't understand what these people are doing. And they're telling you one thing and doing something else. Well, back in that day, they did not have a name for incest because apparently it was not as prevalent as it is today. But it is a very prevalent thing today. And Paul said for them to judge him. He said, I've already judged him. What you need to do rather than talk about him is remove him from the church. Make sure he's not functioning in the church until he stops having sex with his father's wife. Praise the Lord. And so this is what we should understand, that we are supposed to recognize that when we come to church, we are supposed to address immoral behavior. And tell people, now, wait a minute. You know, we're not putting you down. We're telling you that you need to cease and desist from immoral behavior. Are you listening to me? All right, let's read on. And to what? The spirits of just men made perfect. Someone say the church. Now, what is this? When you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, it is your spirit that is born again. According to the book of Romans, your body is adopted. That means he places these bodies that are baptized in water in Jesus' name and the temples that our spirits live in and our souls live in, these bodies are adopted. Someone say adopted. That means God legally places us in the kingdom of God temporarily until we get our new bodies, which are from heaven. Our spirits, which is our mental disposition or the life of the body, is born again. That means what we're mentally disposed to do now, we have received the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit inspires our thinking now. And everything that comes to us now, first of all, it comes by our spirit or by our mind. And then it goes into our heart or our resolve, where we reach our final resolve after we have thought about it. If we listen to the Holy Ghost will tell us what to do about it. Then if we will do what the Holy Ghost tells us to do, then our resolve, we say, I'm going to do what God said to. I'm going to do the right thing or the righteous thing. Praise the Lord. Brother Lamb, if not, then we say, well, no, I'm going to go out and stomp, kick, and choke her and then get arrested and put on national television so that I can be made to look like a fool, go to court, and be sent to prison. You know, turn to someone and say, you know who he's talking about. And that was not, touch your neighbor and say, that was not the Holy Ghost. And we all know that. Most women now are getting their eyes open to see that this behavior was certainly not of God. All right, what else have we come to? Verse 24, and to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, or someone said the New Testament. The new covenant is where he has agreed to put the new covenant means now he's the mediator. He is the intercessor. He is the one that on our behalf sees to it that the things that pertain to the new covenant are brought to pass. The mediator. Someone say the mediator. So the Holy Spirit is mediating or it is interceding. And as God gives and imparts, the Holy Spirit makes sure that the Word of God is written in our hearts and put where? You ever read that? It's in your Bible, 10th chapter, the book of Hebrews. That's the new covenant. To put it in our mind and where? Write it in our heart. So it becomes a part of who we are. And that's why when we are walking with God now, we cannot feel comfortable with sin. You just can't, if you have any kind of conscience, you cannot feel comfortable. Yes, sin is pleasurable, but it ain't comfortable. Turn to someone and say, it may be pleasurable, but it ain't comfortable. Tell them because hell is in the wings somewhere. When you start thinking about hell, you start saying, well, maybe this isn't a good idea. Can the church say amen? So this is the way that it is with the people of the Lord. All right, media of the new covenant, read, and to the blood of sprinkling, that speaketh better things than that of Abel. Well, Abel was the first martyr, and he shed, his blood was shed as a righteous person. But this blood of sprinkling is not the Abel's blood. This is the blood of who? Jesus Christ. That's what he's saying. The blood of Jesus, which is the blood of sprinkling, is better. It speaks better things than that of who? Abel. That's what he's saying. The blood of Jesus is better than the blood of Abel. It took the blood of Jesus to save Abel. Stretched all the way back to Abel's day and covered him because he was the first martyr to die in Christ, looking to Calvary's cross. Are you listening to me? All right, now you can read the 25th verse in your spare time. I'm going to call your attention now to another scripture, 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We're going to close there tonight. My time is it 9:44? No, it's 9:36, right? Oh, who has the time? I was close. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Someone say the building. You have got to see yourself as the significant part of the church. Now, to show you how wicked the homosexuals are, I received a phone call today. They just came out with a picture in San Francisco of the Lord's Supper being executed by homosexuals. And all of the sacraments are sex toys on the table. Someone say demons. That's all that is. So Sean Hannity had them on Fox News rebuking them for this. But see, I tried to tell you, these people, their agenda is so diabolical, you have no clue. It is unbelievable how wicked and demon-possessed these people are. They are off the charts, beyond human comprehension. You'd have to go into the depth of hell, in the pits that are bottomless, to find out where they are. Turn to someone and say, ooh. They don't scare me. I tell them when I see them, you don't scare me, you better get away from me. Because I'll put you in hell now. Can the church say hallelujah? Put your hands on me. I'm being a little facetious there. But all right, visitors, I don't want to spook them there. But this is what they did. They have no shame. They have no conscience. They just do anything. Say anything, and then they want to try to intimidate you. They don't intimidate me. I'm not intimidated by them. They need to stop it and have some respect for things that are holy. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses number 12 through, we'll stop at verse number 14 and pick it up on next week. Let's read. For as the body is one and have many members, and all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. Now, he's talking about the human anatomy. He's comparing the body of Christ to the human anatomy. As a human anatomy, you look at a person who is a human being, the body is one. But has what? Many members. And 206 or whatever it is, bones, and all of these ligaments and muscles and tendons that wrap around the bone that are referred to in your Bible by the expression sinew. Whenever you read the term sinew in the Old Testament, is referring to the ligaments and the muscles that wrap around your skeletal structure. Are you listening to me? I keep hearing this noise in the back. I hope that's not that bat, but I'm glad these lights is keeping him back there, because if he comes out, I'm out of here. Can the church say hallelujah? I'm dashing right down the center aisle, not toward the baptism booth, but toward my office. Glory. For as the body is one and have many members, and all the members of that body are what? One. Being many are what? One body. So also is Christ. So we're all connected. And we must have respect for that. And we must be willing to work within the biblical theological confines of what the scripture says is good for that. Unity. Someone say unity. Verse 13. For by one spirit are we all baptized into, someone say, Holy Spirit. That is, the Holy Spirit puts us in one body. Uh-huh. Whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, they have been all made to drink one into one spirit. Verse 14, for the body is not one member, but what? But many. I should have stopped at verse 13. We want you to understand we are all connected. And when you find people who are trying to push for disunity, Brother Beta, or separation, or split the church, split the congregation, you ought to know that's not of God. That's the devil. Now, if I had been involved in a split, then I would have to reap a split. Now, I've often said this in my teaching. I told the Pastor Robinson, he now has resigned over in Lansing. And I told him years ago when he came here and getting ready to start his church, I said, now I would suggest that you go back and see Suffolk Bishop Warren and clear that matter up. He said, well, I'm leaving. I said, well, you don't want to question your pastor and provoke him. Obviously, that's what you did. And I said, the thing to do is to reconcile with him. I'm going to start a church. I said, that is not the way to do this. So he said, well, I've already got my microphone and my PA system. I said, well, you better go sell those items and go back to your church. I said, because I'm going to tell you right now, Elder Robinson, Brother Robinson, I said, you're not going to make it. He's walking out the door. I said, listen to what I'm telling you. That was back before we even built the other church we tore down. I said, I'm telling you now, you're not going to make it. Well, he went on out the door. I said, and I'm going to tell you something else. If you try to split his church, then somebody's going to split your church. I said, because you're going to reap what you sow. Well, so he went on out there and started his church. And I told him, I said, now, Bishop Paddock's going to disfellowship you. So he legally started a church, and Bishop Paddock put him out. So he was out there for 5 years. And Brother Hersey was over at Bishop Maxwell's with Bishop Bonner's organization. So Brother Hersey wouldn't go over to him because he didn't want to leave the PAW. But then he left Suffolk Bishop Warren's, went over to Bishop Maxwell's, and he didn't want to leave Bishop Maxwell's organization until Robinson got in an organization. So finally, after 5 years, I saw Suffolk Bishop Warren. He was district elder. I said, so are you going to let him back in? He said, he's going to let him back in. I said, well, he still got to reap. So he came back in, and Brother Hersey came over and joined him, left Bishop Maxwell, went over and joined his church to say that he was going to help him. Brother Hersey told him he was only going to help him for a period of time. So I told Elder Robinson, I said, well, I see you got back in the PW. He said, yes. I said, well, Hersey's going to split your church. And Elder Hersey was with him for like 2 years, and he split his church and took 2/3 of the members. Well, I didn't understand. I want this to be on record. How Elder Hersey could take 2/3 of the members because he couldn't even preach. He preached here. You couldn't understand a word he was saying. So I was wondering, how did he get any members?